Hello, this is Dr. Michael Hassan, the engineering doctor. I'm the recipient of the IEEE Outstanding Educator Award, and this is course titled Microprocessors, Microprocessor Systems for Microprocessors and Microcontrollers. And this is lecture number 3, which is Microcomputer Basics, Section 3. This is a disclaimer for you to read. References, there are numerous number of books and references in the library about microprocessors. Those are a few: M.H. Hassan, Microprocessors and Systems Design; A. Clements, Microprocessors Systems Design; Beard and Peters, Microcomputer Systems; and Tonoka's 68,000 Microprocessors. Microcomputer basics. We covered so far microcomputer evolution, the history of microcomputer technology, microcomputer organization, the personal computer, and also we covered very important useful terms and definitions. Today we'll talk about the M68000 family, programming languages, high-level languages, assembly language, and machine language. The M68000 family. The first processor in this family is the MC68000, which is a 16-32-bit microprocessor. Since it supports a 16-bit data bus while it has 32-bit internal registers. However, this is considered a 16-bit technology because its ALU can perform logical and arithmetic operations on 16-bit data. However, the M68000 is considered a 16-bit, as we said, since its ALU is a 16-bit. The 68000 has 17 32-bit data and address registers. It has 24-bit address and 16 megabyte direct addressing range, because 2 to the power 24 basically will get 16 megabyte. And the 16-line data bus. Operations can be performed on 5 basic data types: bits, binary coded decimal digits, bytes, words, and long words. The M68008 is a 16-bit microprocessor with 8-bit data bus. It has full code compatibility with the MC68000. Like the 68000, the 68008 has no virtual memory and no control registers. It is packed as 48-pin DIP and 52-pin QPP. DIP, of course, is dual inline package, and QPP is quad plastic package. Among the 4 additional pins of the 52-pin package, 2 additional address lines are included beyond the 20 address lines, 48-pin package. Therefore, the direct addressable memory is 1 megabyte and 4 megabytes. 48 and 52-pin packages, respectively. The MC68010 is a 16-32-bit virtual memory microprocessor that has full code compatibility and pin-for-pin compatibility with MC68000. Its advantages over the MC68000 are its support to virtual memory, 3 control registers, and 57 instruction set. It also possesses an asynchronous bus structure with a 24-bit architecture. The 68012 is an enhanced version of the 68010 with virtual memory, 3 control registers, 16-bit address bus, and 30-bit address A1 through A29 and A31. Addressing 500 megabytes of data with A31, differentiating between the two non-contiguous sections. Therefore, the total direct addressing is 1 gigabyte. The MC68020 is the first full 32-bit implementation of the M68000 family of microprocessor using CMOS technology, which allow CMOS which is complementary MOS and HMOS gates to be combined on the same chip for maximum speed. It is implemented with 32-bit registers and data bus, 32-bit addresses with full support of virtual. The 68020 has 4 GB direct addressing range, 7 control registers, 18 addressing modes, and 1 of 3 instruction set, including 7 coprocessor instructions. The M68030 is a 32-bit virtual memory microprocessor that integrates the functionality of MC6820 with paged memory management, MMU, and on-chip 256-byte data cache. It is object code compatible with the 68020 and earlier 68000 microprocessors. The 68030 is enhanced with multiple internal bus and data buses, as well as more versatile bus controller that can support 2 clock bus accesses and 1 clock bus accesses to maximize performance. The MC68EC30 is a 32-bit embedded controller. The MC68040 is an enhanced 32-bit CMOS microprocessor that combines the integer unit processing capability of the MC68030 microprocessor with independent 4K byte data and instruction caches and an on-chip floating point unit (FPU). It maintains 32-bit registers available for the entire M68000 family, as well as the 32-bit address and data paths. It supports 4 GB direct addressing range. The MC68CC040 is a 32-bit embedded controller that streamlines the functionality of the MC68040. The MC68060 and LC60 and EC60 offer super-scale integer performance over 100 million instructions per second (MIPS) at 66 MHz. The MC68060 comes fully equipped with both a floating point unit and a memory management unit for high-performance embedded control desktop application. A low-cost embedded control application, MC68LC60, is equipped with MEU only, but FPU is not required. The MC68EC60 eliminates both the FPU and MEU, permitting designers to leverage the MC68060 performance while avoiding the cost of unnecessary features. The MC68-3XX is a family of compatible microcontrollers that use a 68000-based CPU core, CPU32, 68EC000. Many modules are available in the MC68-3XX family, such as Timing Processing Unit, TPU, General Purpose Timer, GPT, and Auxiliary RAM, Network Interface Processor, and Qt Serial Module. The Coldfire processor, starting in the late 1990s, Motorola launched a series of Coldfire MFC5XXX microprocessors, such as the MCF5206, 5206E, 5249, 5290, 5272, 5280, 5282, 5307, 5407, with operating a frequency up to 220 MHz. The Coldfire core is based on MC68000 architecture with several functions such as DRAM controller, or DMA timers, parallel and serial interfaces, and system integration. The microprocessor chip also has an instruction cache, data cache, and SRAM. Dragon Ball or MC68328 is a 68000 core-based microcomputer designed as an all-in-one global solution handheld computer use. The processor is capable of speeds of up to 16.58 MHz and can run up to 2.7 MIPS, million instructions per second. The base 68328 and the login PC, which is MC68Z328 model. It was extended to 33 MHz 5.4 MIPS for the Dragon VZ, which is the MC68VZ328 model, and 66 MHz 10.8 MIPS for the Dragon Ball Super VZ or the MC68SZ28. The more recent Dragon Ball MX microcontrollers, later named the Freescale IM. X MC9328MX MCI MX series. If Freescale is still in operation and it is a replacement for the local company. Programming languages. To use any computer, we must provide a program code that ultimately defines a series of machine instructions to solve a task to solve a task or a problem. The task is often given in a plain English language. Then the programmer shall define a procedure to solve this task. This is a procedure called algorithm. Algorithms are stepwise procedures which can be used to define the steps in a program or in programs, step by step until the final conclusion of the task. You may come with more than one algorithm to solve one specific task. An algorithm can be written in plain English or as a pseudocode. Pseudocode or ALGOL is a basic English-like algorithmic language similar to Pascal. ALGOL is simply, actually, algorithm stands for algorithm language. Algorithmic language. Now, often we use, a programmer sometimes uses flowcharting. Flowchart is a visual method to represent an algorithm. There is an NC, which is the American Standards Institute, standard for the flowchart, symbols and a flowchart layout. And as shown in the diagram here, we have the symbol, we have a rectangular, which is a process, a predefined process shown in this shape here, which is a rectangular, two small lines at the beginning and two small lines, a tilted rectangular for output, and this shape is used for decision making, and a connector could be used, elliptical shape or a circle, a small circle, and similar to elliptical shape with a rounded corner here, it is a rectangle with a rounded corner. Terminator could be the starting point and the end. And this shape, which is a very similar to the terminator, alternate process. So this is actually the symbols used in flowcharting. Now, programming languages as an example of pseudocode could be represented as a high-level language. Find the mean of k numbers. State an algorithm to achieve this task, represent the algorithm pseudocode, and find its visual flowchart. Now, this is a quite simple problem. We'd like to have, we have a set of numbers, k. We will add them all together, then we will divide by the integer k to find the mean, of the number. So the algorithm, this task is quite obvious. Add all k numbers, then divide by the integer k. The algorithm may be represented by the following pseudocode. We will reset the sum to 0 for I equals to k down to 1. Sum will be equals to sum plus an I. So initially we will pick the first number, which is the nk, then and k minus 1 until n 1. We'll pick up all the numbers and we will accumulate, and this is an accumulator, which is the sum is updated every time, the old sum of the new. We int for, this is a for statement, well, for, and the mean will be equal to the sum divided by k, which is the total number of the numbers n I. So this is the pseudocode. The flowchart of this problem is simple as well. Start will initial sum to zero, and you will set I to k. K is the number of numbers n. Now sum equals to sum equals n I. We subtract I from I minus 1. So initially it was k, then k minus 1. First cycle. Then is I greater than 0? If it is yes, we will repeat, and we are decrementing I every loop. Then once I is 0, we get out, and the mean m equals to the sum divided by k, and end the process. So this is the flowchart for the pseudocode of a simple calculator to calculate the mean of a set of numbers, and the number of numbers is k. Let's say k is 10, so we have 10 numbers. If k is 20, we have 20 numbers. We add those numbers and we accumulate them, value of the sum. Then we get the mean. He is looking for the mean, which is equal to the sum divided by k. Now, once we have the pseudocode and the flowchart, we can write really any problem that we want. A high-level language consists of English-like statements and common grammatical and logical symbols. The programmer does not need to know the internal microprocessor architecture, its addressing modes, or its instruction set. The code written in high-level language is called the source code. The source code can be converted to machine language by using a program called compiler or interpreter. The machine code is called the object code. There are many high-level languages with special purposes, like Fortran and COBOL, which is a business applications. Fortran is a scientific language started way back, very early in the last century. And C, C++, Java, etc. Clearly, C++ and Java are known and popular languages today. As an example, we'd like to write a high-level language to add two integers, 30 and 50, in decimal. We'll use the same example in the next example. Talk about a simple language. So the solution is quite simple. I assign the two integers to x and y, then add x and y. All he is looking for is to add x and y. So x will be 30, y equals to 50, then z is equal to x plus y, which is 30 and 50, and definitely expect the result is 80 or 80. Z is simply is the or z is the required sum of the two integers. Assembly language. Assembly language is a programming language based on the internal microprocessor architecture, its addressing modes, and its instruction set. Assembly code is called the source code. An assembler is a programming utility which converts the assembly language source code into a machine code. The machine language code is called the object code. A close assembler is a programming utility that uses one computer to develop an object to code to be used on a different computer. Programming in assembly language is more efficient than high-level language. Program efficiency is defined by the minimum execution time and minimum storage area, which is less number of bytes in the machine code. A carefully written assembly language program outperforms its counterpart in the speed and storage area. As a matter of fact, even when we write an assembly language program, some people may end up with very long code because it is not an efficiently structured program. And the people who use the best instructions and produce the minimum number of bytes in the machine code, and the execution time of such machine code will be much less, be an optimal. With assembly language, one can understand the programming, branches, tags, and procedures more clearly than high-level language. The programmer would feel the data flow and how it is manipulated on a step-by-step basis. Assembly language program consists of four fields: the label field, instructions, and mnemonic or opcode field, operand field, and command field. It is recommended that the first 10 columns be reserved for the label field, followed by the instruction, then the operand field. At least one space must be left between the instruction and the field. After the operand field, you can place any comments on that, on what this instruction does. The command field starts with a semicolon or a star. As a matter of fact, the command field could be the complete line. So if you start the line with a semicolon or a star, the whole line could be used as a command field even without any instruction. So you may have multiple lines as a comment at the very beginning to explain the problem and to explain even the solution if you wish. In the operand field, an instruction may have one or two operands, while some instructions do not have any operands. In case of two operands, the first operand is called the source operand, while the second operand is called the destination operand. This is, could be really upside down in other processors. This is only specifically for the 68,000 processor. The command field is optional. You must have the label field even if you don't have any labels. So the first 10 columns will stay blank even if you don't have a label, okay, because the assembler would expect that those columns are blank. Now, as an example, we would like to write an assembly language program to add the two integers 30 and 50 in decimal, as we explained it previously. The assembly language program could be as follows. We will org at 400 hex. What we are saying here, this is a pseudocode or an assembler directive. We are asking the assembler to start the program at 400 hex. So the program will be saved in the memory at 400 hex. The next instruction is a move instruction, move that B, so the size is a byte. And the hash sign represent basically immediate data. So we are immediately moving 30 decimal to D0. And this is the register D0, one of the registers of the microprocessor. And we'll move the same thing, immediate 50 to D1. So the decimal 50 will be in register D1. Then we'll add B. This is add B. B signifies a byte operation, byte operation. So the size of the data would be 8-bit or byte. We are adding D0 to D1. So D0 will be 30 and D1 is 50, but when we add, the result will be in D1, which is this will be D1 equals to D0 plus the previous D1. So D1 will be in hex, of course, equivalent to 80, which is the sum of 30 plus 50. So three instructions, and we will end. And will be also a pseudo instructions of directive, assembler directive in the 400. It means in the program that started before. Now, when you assemble this program, generate the list file, look at the list file, and the list file will give me not only the compiled or assembled program, give me also the machine code, as we shall see very shortly. So machine language is the real language used by the processor, therefore no development tools are needed for the language, for this language. It consists of all zeros and one, often represented by hexadecimal digit, hexadecimal digits, for simplicity and compactness. It is known as the machine code or the hex code because the data will be in hex. Every microprocessor has its own machine language instructions. Therefore, a machine language program for one microprocessor will not run on another microprocessor unless the two processors are compatible. And we have seen really the M68000 family is a compatible family. It is very difficult to write a program in machine code directly. Hence, programs are usually written in assembly language, then converted to machine language by using the appropriate assembler, manually hand assembled if assembler is not available. Assemblers are usually produce the machine language object code in hexadecimal separately and or combined with the list file. The list file is a comprehensive file consists of the assembly language source code and the machine language code, as we shall see in the following example. Every line in the machine language will have a line number followed by the address indicating the location of the code of that line in the memory, then the machine code of the line followed by the original assembly language instruction. Pseudo instructions, we have seen two, like and end, or assembly directives would not generate any machine code. So in this example, we'll repeat the previous assembly language program to add two integers 30 and 50 in decimal. And we know the program. We will take this program to assembler that we can get 68,000 assembler is very popular, it's available. And when we assemble it, we generate this code. So the 400 will give me that this is started at 400 and does not generate any machine code. Then the instruction move that B immediate 30 to D0 will start at 400 but will generate the machine code 103C001A. And this machine code would be equivalent to 4 bytes, as you can see. 10 is 1. 3C is 2, 00 is 3, and 1E is 4, so we get 4 bytes. So the next line will start at 404 hex. And the machine code for that B immediate 50 to D1 will be 123C0032. And this is also a 4 byte. The machine code is 4 bytes, so the next line will start at 408. And add that B D0, D2, the machine code is the 2-byte code, which is D200, and we'll end the process. By 400, it means we'll end the program started at 400, and end, since it is pseudo instruction or assembly directive, does not generate any machine code. You see here it's blank, there is no machine code. So from the list file, the machine language code, which is the object code in hexadecimal, will be 103C001E, 123C0032, D200. Simply, we are reading them from here. See the machine code? Start here, 103C001E, 123C0032, D200. This is the code. This is the real code needed for the processor to execute this program and give me the sum. Since every two hexadecimal digits represent 1 byte, this code is 10 byte long. To determine the length of the code, we can count the length either manually by hand. If the program is too long, we will look at the address of the first instruction. The address of the first instruction with machine code is this, at 400. The address of the last instruction of 408, but this is the beginning of the instruction. We have 2 bytes here. So if we take 408 minus 400 and get 8 plus 2 bytes, you will get 10. So the total will be 10, and it is really 10 bytes, because you will put 4 bytes plus 2 bytes, the total 10 bytes code. Again, the 2 came, the last line, which consists of 2 bytes, D2 and 00x. This is all, actually. Thank you so much for listening. Please subscribe. I will see you very soon. And this will be the end of Section 3. Sincerely, Dr. Hassan. Thanks.